Okay, that's the end. Sorry for the abrupt ending. So, entrepreneur number two, her name is Yante Bakir, also from Labuan. She's been in business less than 20 months. Actually, she started just before the lockdown last year. Just before. Wow. Her products is called, her brand is called YB Collection, which is after her name. She's selling hijab and purda. So this is her video. Have a look.
Like a small boat on the ocean, sending big waves into motion, like how a single word can make a heart open. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion. And all those things I didn't say were acting balls inside my brain. Now the scream went out tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm all right song. Not that we're starting now. Starting right now, I'll be strong. Losing friends and I'm chasing sleep. Everybody's worried about me. In 2D, say I'm in 2D. It's been 2 years, I miss my home. There's a fire burning in my bones. Still believe, yeah, I still believe. And all those things I didn't say, wrecking balls inside my brain. I was screaming out tonight. Can you hear my voice this time? This is my fight song. Take back my life song. Prove I'm alright song. I might only have one match, but I can make an explosion.
Thank you. Those the two videos, I hope they are inspiring to all of you who are thinking of being in business. Despite all the challenges, they managed to overcome them, as I said earlier. Why is that? What are their success factors? I'll give you three that from what I see here. Number one, they keep learning. They continue to learn and adapt. Adapt to the situation, the COVID-19 or whatever mistakes they have made, they learn from it and they move on. Number two, they keep going. They never give up. Failure is just not an obstacle, it's just another step towards success. That's how they see failures. Failures is just a step towards success. And last but certainly not least, they are focused. They entrench in themselves the goal that they want. The goal, whatever, it could be the best seller for the products in the country, in the region. Maybe to make R1 million, $1 million. Whatever it is, they are focused. They don't let any other things, any other obstacles to be a hindrance to them in achieving their goals. I will share you one quote, which I really, really like, from Bruce Lee. This is how he said, this is about being adaptable. Empty your mind. be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend. Thank you very much.
It's amazing, it says, huh?
Yes, this is the phone number. You may want to take down the number, or you can contact me later or through the organizer. If you want to contact them, get to know them, or you want to order their products. For Brunei, it is very near. Although we are not open yet, somehow we will get to you through courier service. And however it is, I hope this has been a learning point for all of us. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Azhar. Now we'll go for the Q&A from the audience. And guys, do you have any question for Mr. Azhar? So you can actually type at the chat box area. While waiting for them, Mr. Azhar, I have a few questions. Did the government actually provide any training to the participants from day one until today? For example, when I see the Humay sambal, the packaging was quite simple, and then now it transformed into something supermarket worthy with the packaging, with the color combination.
Yes, they do. For Humay sambal, they have a course. She attended a course on packaging in KL. So from that, just normal, because the problem is because Labuan is an island, anything that you,
right.
For every order, you have to send it by air. So the cost of logistics, because the package or the glass is heavy, so that is a problem, right. Making it expensive. So she tried and she get some consultation from others, and they decided to put it in a pack. If you see the one, I forgot to.
Right. They're having the sealed pack.
It's a simple package, very light, and it's easy to send over. And she also has one. She actually joins a few expo. Called one of them is Maha, Malaysian Halal Showcase, which is the largest in the world. And also she got grant from government for 20,000 ringgit. So that's actually, all this actually helped her to move on and to be better in her business. Likewise, for Yante, she got help from the government in expo, and also from her mentor to help her in marketing and promotion. Yes, that's an answer.
That's great, Mr. Azhar. And then for Yanti, when she actually opened before the COVID, how did it actually impact her, and how did she actually overcome the situation?
Okay, her problem is because at the worst, something like I think it was June this year, there was no courier service, there was no delivery, right. And you cannot, in fact, export outside Labuan. So what she did, it was hard actually. It was hard, and business went down.
Entrepreneur.
Yes, it was. So what she did was she focused on local market in Labuan, and she can actually, she talked to them on WhatsApp, on the phone, and then just promoted in social media, and then she actually delivered when she can, because even at that time it was total lockdown. You cannot even go out. So actually business plummeted, but she tried to deliver as much as she can within the island.
Awesome. Mr. Azhar, we have a question here from Faizul Azim. The question is, how do you overcome the challenges of having a small market such as Brunei and Labuan?
Oh, yes. The thing is, that is called physical market. Right? It's a geographical market. So you don't limit yourself to your geographical market. If your product is good, why not, for example, this sambal, it could a lot of people in probably in Indonesia, in Singapore, in Thailand, or anywhere in the world actually probably like it. It's just that they don't know yet. So why stop you from exporting? So now you have social media marketing. You can market through Facebook, Instagram, and so on. So there's nothing to limit you. And courier service also go everywhere, right? So right now, yes, probably 10 years ago, would have been a problem. But now, just use social media, use digitalization, use the courier service, and you can go everywhere.
That's great. Thank you, Mr. Azhar, and thank you, Faisal, for the question. Do you have any more questions from the audience today? I think we have about 1 or 2 minutes left. So, Mr. Azhar, one last question from me. So, BIMP-EAGA is a platform where we can actually, for the entrepreneur, can actually expose their product as well, correct, Mr. Azhar? I mean, you coming from the country director of BIMP-EAGA Malaysia. So, can you tell us more about the function of BIMP-EAGA and how it actually connects and helps our future and local entrepreneur here?
Okay, I'll try to be brief. That's a long, actually, that needs a long answer. But basically, we are the private, we represent the private sector. BIMP-EAGA has a government sector. We are the private sector. So we try to help private sector to do business, to do trade, to do investment and tourism throughout the four countries of BIMP-EAGA. And we do projects within the four countries. It can be 2, 3, or 4, all four countries. So government will facilitate with regulations and whatever that needs to be handled. And for this particular, we also want to help the small entrepreneurs. My plan is to have sort of a sales pitch or business matching program with Labuan, with these two entrepreneurs I just mentioned, starting with Brunei. We'll have a business matching program with Brunei, and then we'll expand it to include probably Kalimantan, Sulawesi, Philippines, and so on, so that we can help them to expand their market in BIMP-EAGA. That's the kind of thing that we do in BIMP-EAGA.
Thank you so much, Mr. Azhar, for your time this morning. And I'll pass everyone to the second moderator for the next topic. Thank you again, Mr. Azhar. Assalamualaikum and be safe.
Waalaikumsalam. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Cikgu Hafizal. So just a quick sound check. Can everyone hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, we can.
Yes.
Is Ms. Danica here?
Yes. Good morning.
Good morning, Ms. Danica. Okay, so I think, I guess we are ready. Okay. So, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh and a very good morning to everyone. Okay, so another speaker we have with us here today is Ms. Danica Tan, Vice President Sales and Marketing from Allison Shipping, BIMP-EAGA Business Council, Zamboanga, Philippines. So Ms. Danica, we are pleased to have you here with us today and I'm honored that I get to moderate the session for you to share your success story. So without further ado, all the way from the Philippines, we welcome Ms. Danica Tan. So the floor is yours.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Pleasant day to all the participants in this webinar. Hope you are well and hope we are all coping well during this time of pandemic. I am Danica Tan, the VP of Sales and Marketing of Allison Shipping Lines. I am also the director for BEBC Zamboanga, Philippines. I am here today to share some of the success stories of our family business, which was started by my grandfather way back in 1978. I will be presenting my slides. Sorry. Sorry, I'm trying to. Sorry, having technical difficulties with my slides. Okay. Okay, can everyone see my slides?
Yes.
Yes, we can.
Okay, so for those unfamiliar with our company, Allison Shipping Lines, I will firstly be sharing with you our company background. So back in 1978, Allison Shipping Lines started with a vessel called MV Australia Del Mar, which was capable of transporting passengers and cargoes. Without any experience in the shipping industry, my late grandfather Feliciano Tan Sr. took the challenge along with my grandmother, where they eventually learned step by step the intricate dynamics of the shipping business. 2 years later, they acquired its second vessel, the MV Allison, which was a purely cargo vessel that was deployed in the tramping operations. The 1980s saw the company's rapid expansions as more cargo vessels were acquired every year. A third vessel, MV Alexander, was principally engaged in the barter trade route between Singapore and back during this period. During the 1990s, Allison shifted its concentration on the Ro-Ro passenger sector as more Ro-Ro ramps were being put up by the government to the Philippine Ports Authority. Additional vessels were added to cater to more passengers and cargo. Our main port of call is in Wanga City in Mindanao, but some of our passenger ferries are actively in service for different domestic provinces in the Philippines. As 1994 dawned, then President Fidel Ramos spearheaded an economic and trade relations with the country's closest neighbors, namely Brunei, Indonesia, and Malaysia, thus the birth of BIMP-EAGA. Only Allison Shipping Lines answered and came forward to venture into this uncharted route between Zamboanga and Sandakan Port in Malaysia. Allison's MV Danica Joy 1 was the pioneer vessel that sailed in this route. Her sail made the start of all BIMP-EAGA route in the Philippines, and the rest was history. Danica Joy was then upgraded to the Danica Joy 2 and became a Sandakan ship. Once a week on her off Sandakan route, Danica Joy 2 will also sail the Zamboanga-Jolo route, which was her original route. She sailed for a long time, but because she's needed in the route. Regarding economics of the route, on the return trip, there will always be traders going back, and the old Danica Joy 2 is almost always filled with cargo plus deportees. As of recent, we have upgraded our vessel to the MV Antonia, accommodating more passengers with better facilities for their comfort. We have actually invested in upgrading our vessels through the years. Going to Sandakan, there will be traders and visitors, plus this is respectable cargo too, including goods prohibited to Muslims. There will always, otherwise, those motorboats won't always be making voyages anymore. However, the commodities from Zamboanga to Sandakan was never constant, as products such as seaweeds, mangoes, etc. are seasonal. Allison actually serves as control in the Zamboanga-Sandakan legal trade. Immigration, PPA, military are well involved to ensure passengers who board the vessels have the right documents and cargoes as well. In 1999, the company expanded into containerized cargoes, thus the additional of new, bigger cargo vessels. The con carriers, which serves the ports of Manila, Cebu, Calibo, and other parts of the Philippines. The first fast craft of the corporation was bought on 2004 and was named MV Seajet. At present, Allison operates a fleet of 36 vessels and has become the dominant shipping operator in Western Mindanao. In my next slide, I will be playing a video of Zamboanga City and some of our vessels.
Run away, far away, so you can escape all the mess in my head.
As you can see in the video, this is the port of Zamboanga City, which is only 16 hours away from Malaysia, from Sabah, Malaysia. This is our MV Antonio vessel that flies from Zamboanga City to Sandakan Port. We carry both cargoes and passengers. And currently, we have also deployed our concarriers, our purely cargo vessels, for those who do trade within the BIMP-EAGA region. Yes, I hope everyone enjoyed the video. So in addition, we got involved in the BIMP-EAGA because of my grandfather's determination and strong belief in humanity. The government invited us and no one wanted to take on this challenge, but my grandfather made the commitment to the government, which he stuck through even without making any profit for the first few years. Yet we still continued, which eventually became one of the active BIMPC connectivity even to this day. The BIMP-EAGA has helped us in the facilitation of trade in the neighboring countries. The agency has given us opportunities to grow the business and expand. BIMP further promotes good governance, and thus we work hand in hand with ensuring that we fully support their plans for the betterment of sea connectivity, as well as ensure that we all work together as community, regardless of culture or religion. After learning and attending several meetings and conferences where my father would take me, I took interest in the potential of BIMP-EAGA, where I was assigned to be director for BIMP-EAGA Business Council Zamboanga. I am very proud of what my grandparents started. It was a very noble undertaking, and the fact that the ship that serviced the maiden BIMP-EAGA route bore my name made me feel deeply honored. Today, being one of the BIMP-EAGA directors, I understand it is a privilege and at the same time a great responsibility. Although I just started, I immediately took interest in BIMP-EAGA's concept and objectives. There are a lot of opportunities for development, especially that resources are readily available. We just have to explore and maximize its potential, and I take it as a personal challenge to participate and create more stories for BIMP-EAGA. I want to continue what my grandparents started and build on it. I know their vision, which I share, is to strengthen trade and investment through sea connectivity so that we can improve the lives of the people in the region. I am excited and optimistic with this endeavor, and I look forward to a strong partnership amongst the neighboring countries to achieve sustainable development. So during this pandemic, we have encountered several problems, which where our passenger vessels were put on hold, but we still continue our cargo vessels, though with restricted movement and minimal flow of cargoes, since most businesses were closed. Unfortunately, we were operating at a loss, but we knew that this was the least we could do to contribute to our economy and help the community during the pandemic. Our very heroic crew and employees have truly shown their dedications to their jobs. However, we also had to minimize costs by implementing a skeletal force, although we made sure that we have support them with the goods and allowance to compensate. Adapting to the new normal was not easy, as we had to adapt to changes, which was sudden for us. And I'm sure it was for other businesses too. Our company had additional expenses for us to be able to comply with the health protocols for both passengers and crew. We also had to face unavoidable circumstances in our transactions and operations which contributed to our loss too. In addition, we had to make sure we maintained our vessel's condition even when supplies and parts were limited, since importation and logistics was difficult at this time. There were lockdowns everywhere, so labor and delivery were definitely almost impossible. But we had to bear with it. Time went by and expenses were adding each day. But we still continued regardless of the constraints. It took almost half a year for cargo movement to pick up. However, until this very day, our passenger vessels are still irregular, with only 50% capacity, and our employees still on skeletal workforce. Alison has extended its efforts to contribute to the country in fighting the pandemic by ferrying frontliners as well as patients to and from the nearby provinces, since our Zamboanga's neighboring islands like Holobasilan have only limited access to hospitals and facilities. We have also assisted in ferrying locally stranded individuals in the Philippines, together with local and international agencies. As for our cross-border trade, we have been given the opportunity to bring home returning overseas Filipinos from Sabah, a mission involving task force agencies in the Philippines, together with the National Security of Sabah, Malaysia. We are currently on our seventh trip with a total of 13 trips. However, we were also asked to stop our cargo vessels from plying the route, which have really disrupted the supply chain of foods. All concerning agencies have been involved in this mission, which so far have been successful, even with the pandemic. Our cargo vessels and RORs have continuously been transporting essential goods with only minimum or lesser freight, since we do understand the challenges all the business owners have been facing. Cargo movement was slow due to the limited workforce, and we had to deploy our RORO vessels without any passengers and only several cargo load for medical and relief goods. We still managed to transport goods to the respective cities just to be able to utilize the use of our assets for the well-being of the community. As mentioned earlier, we have assisted the National Security of Malaysia to ferry home returning overseas Filipinos back to the Philippines. There have been challenges in the process, such as lack of facilities and testing centers in both cities. Also, the minimal movement of people involved during the planning stage. But we have successfully accomplished this through our online meetings. Thankfully, for the frontliners and concerned agencies who have actively participating on the proper handling of the ROFs. So some strategies of our company came up with are as follows. We had to identify pockets of growth. We found commodities and products that are least affected by the pandemic. Some examples of these types of products include pharmaceutical and essential goods. This strengthens and attains full load capacities. We also found it important to invest in digital capabilities, where we have to digitalize our entire system, which is also very costly and time-consuming. As employees, we also have to adapt to the new system, taking into the consideration that our employees also work from home. It may be convenient in the long run, but the whole process gave us limited time and resources to fully equip them. Though we believe that investing in digital would contribute to our overall operations. Think of real-time data that will improve communications and relationship with customers and partners. It is also to assist in transforming the services offered by identifying bottlenecks and improving delivery and service. The virus is not going to disappear overnight. So to ensure that shipping and logistics business can cope with the effects of COVID-19, it is imperative to devise strategies that can cushion the blow of reduced demand for shipping. By reconstructing costs, finding pockets of growth, and investing in digitization, it is possible to recover and even grow during these hard times. So thank you everyone for your time and for opportunity to introduce our company, as well as to speak about my experience in the BIMP-EAGA. I hope I was able to enlighten everyone of some of our success stories. Thank you and keep safe.
Thank you, Ms. Thank you very much, Ms. Danica. That's actually very interesting and very informative. Definitely trading is a very important in the economy, and it is greatly affected during the pandemic. Actually, I have a few questions, but that has already been answered in your latest slides. Okay. So looking at the time now, I think I'll just pose a question. Okay. I think this could be useful for the late activities. So The thing is, you already mentioned about the challenges that you posed during the pandemic, how it is actually very important to pivot or to actually focus on the essential items, the essential goods such as pharmaceutical of shipping. So looking at your success stories, probably the audience are interested maybe in the future to venture in this business. So what would be your advice, okay, to the participant, to those who are very interested to venture in this business? So what would be your advice for those who are actually very interested to venture in this business?
Well, the shipping industry is actually very challenging, yet a rewarding business venture. My advice to entrepreneurs and business people who are venturing to enter the industry is for them to study the market and prepare a business plan. Next, prospective players should have the determination, focus, and persistence in executing the plan. And at the same time, be mindful of other factors, such as the restrictions brought about by the pandemic. Likewise, I suggest that entrepreneurs must keep an open mind and be ready to adapt to the changing business climate. If successful, it is rewarding because satisfied clients means we are able to help them in realizing their dreams and goals. The shipping industry is not an easy business, but it feels very rewarding to be able to connect people through sea connectivity, as well as to contribute to business operations and to boost tourism. I hope it answered your question.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Anika. Okay, so due to our time constraint, let's see if we have any question from the audience. I think I can take only one question. I'm so sorry for that.
Sorry.
So, but actually, I would love to actually to continue this discussion. It's actually very interesting. Okay, I think I have one question here. So it comes from Faizul Azim. What would you say the challenges of regional trade between BIMP-EAGA countries, such as in terms of security, trade restrictions, or red tapes, if present or available?
Oh, sorry. Maybe I can read it again. What would you are the challenges of regional trade, such as in terms of security, trade restriction, or red tape? Well, in terms of security and trade restrictions, we have this is why we have BIMP-EAGA to assist us with all those concerns, because we can. These are very are unavoidable, especially in Malaysia, in between the trade of Malaysia and Zamboanga. So this is why we have the support of BIMP-EAGA to help us have a smooth flow for the movement of our vessels.
Okay, thank you. So thank you, Ms. Danica, and also thank you for Faisal for the questions. So I think we have to end the session now for our session. So thank you very much, Ms. Danica, for the lively, enlightening, and inspiring presentation. And we really hope that this has given our participants for more ideas for their activity later. Okay, so yes, thank you so much.
Questions okay. Or interest in BIMP-EAGA or in our company or to do business, anyone is welcome to email me. I will be providing my email in the chat box.
Okay, thank you. So the audience, so you can actually check in the chat box later for the details for the company. Okay, so again, thank you very much, Ms. Zanika. So now I hand this over to our next keynote address, okay, to the next moderator.
All right, thank you very much. So before we start, can everyone hear my voice?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so we is Mr. Arcelos here?
Yes, I'm here. Good morning.
Yeah, great. Okay, all right. So, Assalamualaikum, good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for investing your time on a Wednesday morning. So my name is Atika Leong from Polytechnic Brunei, and I'm the moderator for this session. So for today, we have an amazing speaker. I'm sure all of you are familiar by now, Mr. Estrella Silo on the Circa 1740 Coffee, where he'll be talking about his success story. So before we start, just a brief introduction about his company. So he is the COO and co-founder of Waraco Incorporate, and he's also the co-founder of Growing Cafe Restaurant and registered trademark, which is Taplido, that sells coffee, sounds interesting, nutritious food, and native delicacies. So his company, Waraco, also won one of the 50 United Nations Best Small Business, Good Food for All of 2,000 companies from 135 companies. Countries, given by United Nations Food System Summit 2021, held in July 2021. Congratulations, Mr. Arstilo. And now let us welcome our guest keynote speaker, Mr. Arstilo.
Good morning, Mom. Good morning. Good morning, everyone. It's so wonderful to see you all again. I've received a lot of messages in Instagram, LinkedIn, and Facebook yesterday, and I tried to respond to all of you. You have so many wonderful ideas and startups, and I hope I would be able to contribute to your growth in your next steps. So yeah, just keep them coming, and I try to respond to all of them. Again, good morning. I just took my breakfast. I had this fruit cake from Austria. It's so wonderful. This time of the year that we have that kind of fruit cake. So it's very beautiful, and you drink it with coffee. So now I proceed with my presentation, but before that, I'd like to see some hearts and thumbs up. How are you today? Press thumbs up and heart sign in your screen. And to know if you're there, you're alive, you're still there in your skin, press thumbs up and heart. Okay, I'm seeing thumbs up. That's good. You're there. You're alive. And I think you're all here participating. There are around 200 people here in the screen. All right. Okay, I'll share my screen now to share my success story. Okay. One moment, please. It's uploading. Okay. Window. I'm going to share the window. Okay. Do you see my screen now? Do you see it now? Yes? Yes. Oh, that's great. That's great. Okay. So now, I summarize the situation right now, this pandemic, in three words. Remote, unequal, and discontented. They capture the conditions in business transaction, economic growth, and individual dynamics, respectively. Meaning, right now, discontentment is also growing in the era of social media, where there are values and extreme ideologies, you know that for sure, especially in Southeast Asia, measuring others' success with the number of likes, followers, or shares. All of these effects can create either social tensions or improvements in our workforce of talents, all right? The workforce can either give strong returns to the company's financials, or it can be a delicate source of talents for the economy. That's what we're experiencing right now during this pandemic. Okay, now, so here, I'd like to show the founders of our company. So there are two of us, Kathleen, who specializes in product development and management, and myself in strategic management and investment relations. That's what I briefly do right now in our company. So just to give you an overview of what we're doing. Now, our journey focuses as a thought leader, impact-driven, and a proudly local company. So we started in 2018. Later on, you will see how we've evolved from 2012 to 2018 and now even during the pandemic that we are expanding. So how did we pivot with our idea given the pandemic? So, and how we managed it? About 18 years ago, during my first year in college, I was asked by my professor what I wanted to do 10 years from now. So I said, I wanted to have my own business in 2013. And I did. I was able to put up a business 10 years since the main professor asked me what I wanted to do then. I put up an agribusiness using the seeds from Brazil, but it failed. I tried again with business development services for SMEs, and it failed again. I failed twice. I tried and tried until I met the right partners, and in 2018, we established Waraco Inc., Timlado, and has now grown to four major companies. So now, from failures, we now have four companies, creating a group of companies. Now, given that growth and that kind of thinking since then, with our idea that us that started as a dip coffee, I introduced to you Timplado and Waraco, a brand that sells artisanal and great tasting coffee, as well as some native delicacies and fusion meals. We have a patented dip coffee system, and this is the facade of our store, these are our foods, and those are our coffee, all of this have expanded during the pandemic, and why I'm going to share it to you later on. Now, with this introduction, how did we pivot? How did we start? Because a while ago, I heard that how could you start a business, or how would you adjust, or how would you do it during the crisis? Because we know our position. Let me show you where we position ourselves. These are some famous coffee shops or restaurants here in the Philippines and perhaps in the other parts of Southeast Asia. So all of these are internationally pivoted, these brands. Now, where did we pivot ourselves? There. We position ourselves in the square, in that part where there's Filipino coffee and Filipino food. So what I'm saying is that sustainable positioning is very important in starting a business. You have to find out where you're really going, which is hard to drive to somewhere where you don't know your position. All right, so that's a very important aspect. Now, we also studied the numbers here in the Philippines. 90% of us drink instant coffee. And there's a 3.8 billion consumption of coffee. And just by getting 1% of $3.8 billion, we're very, very much okay. I can retire at a very early age because of the very strong number of consumers of coffee. And I'm sure it's the same thing in other parts of Southeast Asia. At the same time, we also studied the global revenue of coffee. You see here, these countries are the top consuming countries of instant coffee in the whole world, with the Philippines in number 5. So I want to take part in this market. So what I'm saying here, in order for us to succeed, you have to know where you are. You have to know the numbers. Because if you don't know numbers, if you don't know where you are, where will you go? You have to know your direction. Okay, so now, this is a picture of our manufacturing system. And we hire women and mothers. So that's how we do it. At Marajo and Templado, we have 8 phases. And we are currently at phase 5. In order for us to be completely successful, we have to reach 8 phases, and we are now at phase 5. So we use a backward integration model that we used before reaching phase 5. Wherein, instead of starting with farming, we started with a product. Meaning, we use 4 elements in our business model. The 4 elements are product. Here, you see the products. Digitalization, physical and online spaces, and production. Now, I'm going to show you each of them briefly. So when we say product, we are a patented drip coffee. So meaning we were able to use our utility model, we patented it so that nobody can steal our idea, nobody can steal our product. We have to completely understand how it works, the intellectual property. That's why South Korea is very successful with their care pack, because they were able to use the patent system or the intellectual property, the business model. And that's what we're doing right now. Starbucks, McDonald's, Jollibee, the value of their companies are largely located. 80% of the value of their company are in the patent, in the trademark. So when you try to put a system or an enterprise, you have to completely understand your idea so that you will be able to patent it, to trademark it. Otherwise, you will fail. So you will have to carefully understand this in your own country's terms. So that's our first step for the success. We were able to produce 6 sets of coffees with unique taste profile. Okay, so let me put it back. Yeah, so these are our 6 dip coffee that are patented. So we have different flavors of coffee. And the most famous one is the spicy coffee. And we're distributing it right now, even during the pandemic, because you're staying at home, you need coffee, right? So now, this coffee gives us a bold taste. So, and the second one, we have the e-commerce, digitalization. So from product, the second element of our business model is the e-commerce. We created our own e-commerce. And I'm sure many of you are very capable of creating your own e-commerce because you are used, you know how to code, you are very patient, you are very techie. And these websites, we also did it ourselves. So we have, this is the digitalization part. Because as I said a while ago, we want to become a thought leader of coffee here in Southeast Asia. So meaning, with that e-commerce, we want to become the digital, we want to promote a digital first brand. This is our company. Our company, instead of just being a product, we are a digital first brand. Because this is the new technology now, digitalization. Everything in small squares. That's why we are here in MS Teams, small squares, right? So with that, With that, the third part of our company, of our business model, is this space. We need design thinking. So from product to digitalization, we created a space where people can dine in, where people can talk about the coffee, where we can sell our coffee. And now we're expanding. We're creating more spaces for our Templado coffee. So this is our main branch. You see, we use economical and sustainable materials for our store. It's very Southeast Asian, with some stroke of modern things. So also, because of that, we also trademark our restaurant. As I've said a while ago, 80 to 90% of the value of our enterprise remains here at the intellectual property. It's here in our mind. It's not the product per se, because anyone can steal the product, but nobody can steal your mind. Nobody can steal your idea. But then you have to understand the trademark system in our company. It's very expensive, but we have to do it. That's why McDonald's, Jollibee, it's a Starbucks, they are famous and they are very successful because of the trademark. Now, I'm going to show you how we evolved. In January 2020, when Taal volcano erupted in the Philippines, we are near the volcano. It's like around 1.5 hours away from the Taal volcano. We were still conceptualizing in our phase three, creating the space. And that's the perspective, that's our vision. Now, in April 2020, after the pandemic in March, we began to create our store, and that's the photo, that's the passage. And in June 2020, it's done. We were able to do soft launching. Nobody could dine in. We used the e-commerce. So we created, we did it correctly, that we put first the digital space before the physical space. But even though nobody dines in our store, we have the digital space where people can buy from our store. So that's in June 2020. In July 2020, it evolved again. Because we're earning, we put more improvements in our store. And it's going to be Christmas here. Now, in February 2021, just this year, we were able to create and expand more. We created a second floor from 30 square meters. We are now 60 square meters. All of this during the pandemic, because we created first the digital space. And now in the present, this is our store. We now have a very famous triangle passage, and now we're expanding. We're opening in malls, we're opening in other parts of the country. So this is how we evolved during the pandemic. That's the third item, which is the space, the design and culture. So from product, digitalization, design and space. Now, for the fourth one, so this is how it looks in the morning, and this is how it looks in the evening. So there are two personalities, okay? So that's how our store looks like. Now, the fourth item is about production. This is the last part of our current business model, sustainable farming. We focus as well in farming. So as you see, we didn't start with agriculture. We start with a product, because we need to create first the market. Because if we start immediately in the agriculture part and nobody will buy it, how could we sell it? So here, we're doing more coffee researches. And that's why we won $55,000 from the United States Department of Agriculture for our current research. I'm also into research. We have to continuously develop our products by doing research. You cannot just be satisfied with your own product. You have to continue to do it. You have to continue to research R&D. So we won it. It's an ongoing. We're doing research in Mindanao. So in Mindanao, we're doing this in Mount Apo, where there's the famous Arabica coffee in the world, not only here in the Philippines. Okay, so and aside from that, that bonus point is that we do give to the community. We have that art of giving. We just don't get profits. We give back to the community, for the farmers, for the urban farm mothers, and many other people in our country. So we're doing that, the art of giving. So it's a very important element of our success, is to give back to the community. You just don't get in. You just don't take in. You have to give to the community. So this example, we hire people with disability. We bring the coffee to their places so that they can pack it. Instead of them going to our places, because of the pandemic, they cannot go here. So we go to them. We let them pack it. And that's one way of our art of giving, so that they will have livelihood. There are now 4 million Filipinos who have no jobs. And we want to at least contribute to employment. And this is one example of helping the people with disability. Now, we measure as well our impact. Because how could you move forward if you do not know where you're going, if you do not know your numbers? And we have two kinds of financial statements. One is the financial statement of numbers. One is a financial statement of impact. We have to measure both. This is our impact. Is it commensurate the financial to the income statement and balance sheet. So we measure our numbers so that when we present to the investor, when we present to the world, we know our numbers. You know it by heart. So now we are distributing 50,000. We are now into the 50,000th of our deep copy during the pandemic. And that's very successful because the people help us, because we help them. So it's a tit-for-tat communication, a relationship. And that's one. So now I'm going to summarize our success story in this model. So we begin with the product, and that's our company, Barako. And we have digitalization, we use the e-commerce. We use the space. We now have two aspects, franchising company, and the other one is the restaurant company. That's where we do it. And of course, we do production. We have our real estate company where we do the farm estate. Everything, all of this evolved during the pandemic. Three companies here were established during the pandemic. We see opportunities, we see risk, but with risk, we convert it to gains. And finally, we have to think of the community. We cannot just stop at the production side. We have to consider the community, because all in all together, that is the essence of why we are doing enterprises and entrepreneurship, to give to the community. The giving is a social responsibility. So, and then finally, we were so happy because among 2,000 companies in the whole world, 2,000 companies out of 135 countries this year, we won as a best small business in the Philippines, and we are, I think, just two here in Southeast Asia, one is in Singapore, no, three, and one is in Indonesia. Three of us won here. So yeah, thank you very much again. My name is Aris Asilo, and I hope I was able to inspire you with our success story. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Aristillo, for sharing your amazing story. It was really, really interesting. So now Mr. Aristillo will answer some questions from the participants. So if you have any questions for Mr. Aristillo, you can ask through the chatting sections. Meanwhile, while waiting for the rest to ask the questions, I have a question for you. So I know that entrepreneurships can be a tough role, especially with these difficult times. So how do you stay focused on moving forward and making progress?
Oh, it's very hard. It's very hard to focus, especially with so many things going on. I actually focus by surrounding myself with good people. You know that's one thing. It's focus is not a one-way street. It has to be a two-way street. You tell the people around you, okay, we have to build a team. So it's not a lone star. I'm not a lone star in here. It's a constellation star. So it's like when there's a constellation star, you see people working together. Like, and I think focus is more of helping the other people. When you are focused in helping the community rather than the profit, I don't see my eyes, my mind looking at the money, but I see at the community, right? So when the when you help the community, when you focus on the community, they help you back. And that becomes a very mutual relationship in creating a business. Thank you.
Great. All right. I think there's this one person named Laleska. Well, I've been trying to ask this. I'm dying to know, is spicy coffee a hit?
Yes, it is. Because it hits you twice. It's hot. First, it's hot. Okay, you drink it hot. Oh, it's hot. Then you drink it. There's caffeine. You get a rush. And now it's spicy. So there are three hits in you. It's not just the caffeine. It's not just the hottest, but the third one, the spiciness of it. So we have a very unique concoction for spicy coffee. And then you put honey. It's better because it's like minty. So we have a very interesting coffee. Yeah.
Wow, that's really
yes. But I don't drink that. It makes me palpitate.
Okay. I think there's there's one question from Ayman here. Do you have any plans to expand outside of Philippines? And if so, what would be your strategy? Would it still be the same as in expanding through e-commerce first?
Yeah, we're actually ongoing. We already went to Hong Kong, and then we're now communicating in Middle East. We're doing halal, especially here in Southeast Asia, Brunei, Malaysia. We're ongoing with halal certification. We have a team. I'm not doing it by myself because it's so hard. So we have a team. We have a legal. Our strategy is delegating it to more experts. Like, we have a law firm handling the negotiation. We have a franchising team talking to other investors, but I'm focused more on the investors because we need money to expand. So we have three teams in the West, in Middle East, and here in Southeast Asia. So we have teams working together to achieve that expansion. But it's not gonna happen overnight. I think we need to prepare it for 1 to 2 years because of many regulations, et cetera, halal certification. So it's going to take time.
Great. Okay, I think there's probably we can take one final question here. Do you have any fundamental methods to think about ways to improve the business?
Yeah. There are always fundamental ways. And I think one of the fundamental ways that I do is that you have to continuously do, number one, research and development. That's a very important aspect. You don't fall in love with the product. You fall in love with the problem. Because the problem evolves. You have to give them the value. Because if you fall in love with your product, like Apple, for example, Apple, Macintosh, they continuously to change their products over time. So they didn't fall in love with the product. That was one example of why Steve Jobs failed in the first place during the 1980s, because he fell in love with the product. But when you fall in love with the problem, you continuously to look for solutions and you continuously to improve your products. That becomes the trade. I think that's a very important fundamental way. Fall in love with the solution, with the product, with the problem, not the product.
That's great. Yeah. Okay, I think probably I can take one more last questions here from Real. Yeah. How do you connect with the farmers? Do you have an organization like cooperative? Does it ensure the steady supply of coffee?
That's a very good question. We communicate directly to the farmers. So it's very hard to go. I'm now communicating with 600 farmers. So we have 600 farmers all over the Philippines because of our research and development funded by the United States Department of Agriculture. So we're giving them technology, how to monitor climate. So that's a very important aspect of our model right now. Is we are unique in such a way that we use new technology in monitoring the climate for our coffee. So they have cooperative, but we don't necessarily deal with the cooperative because it's so hard. There's so many red tapes and all. So we communicate directly with the farmers. We buy directly from them. And now we have our own farms. So we also expand. So and that has everything have evolved during the pandemic because of so many things going on. Yeah.
Wow, that's very, very interesting. All right.
Yeah.
Okay. I think probably that's all for now the questions. Okay. Thank you again, Mr. Arstilo, for answering those questions and for the amazing story. It was a pleasure to have you with us. And just by listening for today's session, from the first speaker, Mr. Azhar, who has shared the story of Era and Yante, that show us never give up when doing a business. Meanwhile, Ms. Danica, who are currently running their family business, and of course, for Mr. Arstilo, who is co-founder of Waraco, who owns a patent dip coffee. Hopefully, all of these amazing stories can be inspired everyone who has attended here since day one. So I think that's all, and I'm going to pass this to Puan Farah. Thank you, everyone.
Okay, thank you, Puan Atika, and thank you, Tuan Azhar, Ms. Danica, and also Mr. Arustalo for your insight and for sharing your success stories. I think what we'll do is we'll take a quick 15 minutes break, and then we'll come back, and then we'll pass on to LiveWire for the commencement of the workshop. Thank you so much for your participation, Mr. Azhar, Ms. Danica, and Mr. Arustalo for your for today. Thank you so much. The contact details for all three speakers are on the chat box. So feel free to contact them if you have any further questions or if you need some assistance or any advice. I'm sure they will be more than happy to assist you. Thank you so much.
But yeah, I think it's okay. Let's proceed. Yeah, let's just start the workshop this morning. All right, so we're going to talk about business model canvas. All right, so initially, when we talk about introduction to business plan, it's supposed to be like an article or maybe like how you, when you do your report, you have a lot of information there. In the information, you put in, for example, what are your missions? What are your vision? Who is in your team? Who is basically the specialist in your team? You also consider what are your products, what are the variety of products that you have. Okay, so just some of those things that are very exciting. So I'm gonna quickly share my screen. We're gonna dive into it right now. Okay, I think I'm back. Yep, I am back. Yep. Okay, can you guys see this? If you guys can see this, just give a thumbs up. Yep, okay, good to go. All right, so sorry about that. It happens, yeah, from time to time. Okay, so anyways, very good stuff for today. We're going to talk about the business model canvas. All right, so let me just put up my screen to launch. Yep, so this is basically part of the Shell Lavoie Brunei business model canvas. You can find the business model canvas on the website or any website as well. It's free and it's accessible for everybody. But the thing is, for the business model canvas, why people struggle is that it might be a bit too technical. And this is very exciting because remember the past 2 days, we talked about the lean canvas. We talked about the initial business model, and also we talked about the design thinking. All of that information is going to be very useful for your business model canvas. The thing is, if you've already done the lean canvas, this is going to be super easy year. Because you've already done all of it except four components, okay? But I'm gonna run through it anyways. But because this is our last day, just don't forget to have fun. Do make sure if you guys have any queries or just wanna interact or something, wanna hear from you guys, just pop it up in the chat. I'll be happy to hear. I also want you guys to fully participate if you guys can. The only failure is the failure to participate, means that you guys are just being quiet. But that's okay. I mean, I don't force you guys, but if you guys have any questions, just this is the perfect time to ask. Try to listen and take notes as much as you can. I'll try to make it as easy, as precise, and of course, we'll be in time for lunch, right? Try to speak your mind, ask any questions, as I said. If you feel that, okay, I might have a thought about, say, maybe one component of business model canvas, or maybe you thought that, okay, what if I use this for social enterprise or things like that? Does Facebook use it? You know, all those kind of questions. Yes, pop it up in the chat. I'll be happy to answer them. Okay. Oh, I suddenly hear a sound. Where does that come from? Okay. All right. So let's start the introduction to business model canvas here. So what is a business model canvas? It is a practical business tool to design, test and implement and manage business models. So business model, when people think about it, it's always to do with resources. What are your day-to-day like? What is your operations like? So you'll realize that some of the components are very similar to Lean Canvas, like I said, but in this time, we're going to talk about key partners. What are people you'll be working with? Key activities, resources, customer relationships. These are the four items that are different. So what is it used for? Allows you to describe any business model based on 9 fundamental building blocks. One thing that I want to share with you guys as well, remember when I told you that if you meet an investor, you use a lean canvas, that's okay. But if you want to use the business model canvas, it's also pretty good. That's basically the next step after that. The reason being is because business model canvas sees how the business can be much more operative. It could also allow the investors to gauge in a short span of time, okay, you have a very good return. I can see your potential collaborators. I can see your potential activities in your day-to-day. Okay, I can fund you. I think this is very good. Yeah, so these are some of the things we can look into. So there are 9 fundamental blocks. The difference are that yesterday we were talking about problems and solution. In this case, it's key partners, key activities, key resources, and customer relationships. Those are the different 4 items, yeah? Now, we're going to talk about customer segments. I'm definitely going to run through each component. There is a slight difference, but again, the difference with the business model canvas is that you're supposed to be much more in-depth with it. So it means that if you say, okay, like yesterday, think about it, right? We were talking about anywhere.co. So fun, we want to travel. Who are our customers? There were 9 types of people. Great stuff. But if you were to really focus on just one component or 2 segments, that is okay as well. I think that's really fine. Yeah, so this is where we start to refine things. But again, when we talk about customer segments, in this case, these are the group of people or users or the organizations that you are creating value for. So remember when Mr. Aries is today, he was sharing more about giving contribution to the community, right? This is what you are looking at. These are the people you are trying to give value to. Okay, so there's 3 types of customer segments. Some of people, they look at function. Some people look at social, some people look at emotional. Some customers can be direct or indirect. Direct customers are people who interact directly with you. Indirect are perhaps people that are resellers, right? So you have a set of product, you found an agent to sell the product for you, right? And they get commission and out of it. Now, I want to describe quickly about functional, social, and emotional. Functional, now, think back, yeah? So, for example, functional are basically groups of people who wants to purchase a product because of its function. Straightforward, right? So, for example, I want to get a phone, a new phone. Person A says, my phone is still good. But someone says, you should buy. No, it's good. I don't need to buy a new phone. So they are sticking to just the functional component of it. Or if once the moment they want to buy a phone, they would just want to buy a phone just because of they don't care about the brands. They don't care about any other features. They just want to focus on the as long as you can call, you can message, you get internet. That's great. Yep. So think about your customers in that segment. Now, social is a different aspect. Social is more like, how could you able to create a community out of it? So, for example, nowadays, a lot of people do sports, right? Some people go to the gym and they just work out on their own. Some people like to go to CrossFit or cardio, and they have a community there. So it's really fun. So in this case, like, which one are your preference? Do you want to interact with people or do you feel like you just want to stick, with yourself? And that's okay. In some cases as well, like if you talk about things that are technical, this aspect of social is that you want to make sure that you're sharing your experience with the people around you. Nowadays, gadgets, tools make it so much interactive for people. You can find like some people, some community are preferring one product over the other, and there's a bit of, you know, preference right there. So one such example is that, like yesterday when I said, how many of you guys are Team Jollibee? How many of you guys are Team McD? Right, McDonald's. So that's how it would be, yeah? Team social for McDonald's and Jollibee. Emotional is a very important aspect, I would say, among all these three. Because, for example, in your whole history, the first phone, for example, that you got was a Nokia, right? And then this was given by your parents and you love it, it's great, the internet is good. But for some people, they're like, not too sure, it doesn't have really good stuff, but you hold really strong to it. So that would mean that you're very loyal to your product and you really want to make sure that you want to support it as long as you can, yeah? And that happens. Nowadays, there's also people, if you talk about phones, so many people advocating for Apple. Some people advocate for Samsung, Huawei, Motorola, and all those, you know, the different brands, right? So that's the thing. So emotional basically talks about how are you very loyal to your brand, yeah? Same thing, if you talk about food, yeah, that's pretty simple as well, very easy to describe. So let me move forward from here. Let's talk about value proposition in the middle. So this outlines how a product or service creates value for a customer segment, not the technology or product per se. Yeah. So this basically says, what is the value that you're giving to people? Remember when we described what is anywhere.co in a short span of time, like one single sentence? That is what we want to focus on. We want to focus on a customized travel for people. Easy. They could also say, we want to create a safe and customized travel for female travelers, right? See that kind of value that I described in just a very short span of time? You have to consider when you're designing your product, your business, how can you describe in one short sentence your product to someone else that has never heard about your product, okay? Second item is always in relation to a customer segment. When you create value, you always has to resonate back with your customer. It's the same thing when you talk about problem, has to always resonate back with your customer. You'll find out that, again, the lean canvas and the business model canvas are two different things, but the value proposition is always the same. You talk about value, you talk about the customers. So the last item would be help customers get a job done. right? You don't want to create a product that doesn't solve a problem and that's not going to go anywhere. People are not going to pay money for it. So this is how it's going to look like. Your customers, this is a very happy gentleman. And yeah, if your product is great, then this gift would be handed over to him. And, you know, he could give ratings or reviews and things like that. Okay. This is basically the value proposition canvas. I'm not going to go into depth with this because I think in regards to the business model canvas, that's much more priority. But I want to quickly touch upon this. Now, say you're creating, you have this product, you have a service, you want to make sure that they have a bit of a trait. One of it is that pain reliever. The product is able to solve a problem. Very straightforward, simple, right? And how does that go and resonate with your customer over here? You're helping them, you're solving their issue, their pains. Yeah. So now, for example, if you're coming up with a med tech company, yeah, a medical technology company, are you just creating a product just for people to purchase, or are you actually creating a solution? Think about our situation now, COVID. A lot of companies are trying to create solutions for it. Apps, they talk about creating medicines. That is the current pain all of us are facing and we're struggling with it. And even some companies, they know that, okay, some people are distant now, you know, with their family members and of course, relations outside of the country. How do they solve it? You know, they could perhaps like create an app to contact with their partners outside, you know, or get in touch, make logistics so much easier and things like that. Yeah. Okay, let's talk about products and service and towards customer's job. So product and service, look at the device you're looking at right now, right? Is it an Apple product or is it a Microsoft product or HP or, you know, any of those, right? But the whole point to it is that when you have a product, some of it is used for functions. For example, if you have Adobe allows you to do graphic design, allows you to design videos, make GIFs and all other things as well. And the thing is, when people buy a laptop, right, when you buy a laptop, it's supposed to help you to make your job much more efficient and productive. Yeah. So if you have that trait, your customers are going to be happy. Now, the next and last item would be gain creators towards gains. Yeah. So gain creators is that some people, when you start a launch a product and it will really pick up, right? Sometimes it would be slow. But the moment the hype starts to go up, you have these gains, you know, same thing as you go to the gym. Basically, people say you work out and there's like gains, you know, I'm getting gains, muscles and things like that. But in this case, you're getting people to follow you, to advocate for your product. Are you able to ensure that people are interested in your product? Are you able to ensure that people want to talk about your product? Are you able to ensure that they can convince other people to buy your product? So that's a very important question. Now, I'm not here to tell you that your product should always sell. Yes, it's good to keep, you know, to sell and make sure that your stocks are empty. You know, it's not empty in a way that you don't have any products. It's more like sold out. So you have to be careful. You have to understand the demand of the market. And although some markets are very small, Brunei is one such market as well. But we have to understand some market is not local. It's also expanded outside of Brunei. We have ASEAN. Okay, or BIMP-EAGA in this case. So let me proceed. When do you use which canvas? In this case, use the business model canvas to answer how you are creating value for your business. And you use the value proposition canvas to answer how you are creating value for your customer. Let me linger on this side, on this page for a bit, yeah? So you want to create value for your business. If you're going to do that, use the business model canvas. If you're going to use the value proposition canvas, you are creating value for your customers. Okay. Again, all of this is intertwined. You can definitely look more about it on the internet. But if you have any questions, just let me know. I'll try my best to answer them. Yeah. So let me proceed on forward. The next item would be channels. We talked about channels yesterday in the past 2 days. What is channel? Right. I'm pretty sure you guys already I've heard about this already. It's very simple. It's Facebook, Instagram, but let's dig deeper into it. Channels basically means that you want to make sure, how does your customer interact with you? Why is it so important? Now, you want to sell a product, and the thing is, if you just have a store and you don't market, no one's going to go. The only people that's going to pass by your shop are cats or dogs, yeah, or monkeys, depends where you are. In Brunei, there's a lot of monkeys. Yeah, so you want to get it out. You want to get the word out so people can purchase your product and you can promote it. Yeah, so here it means that you want to communicate and deliver your value proposition. Channels can be direct or indirect. So some channels can be like, you can do it on your own on Facebook, or perhaps you could hire someone to promote for your product or give leaflets and things like that. Yeah, so some testers as well. I've seen some of those happen in different countries, especially in when you talk about food, people want to try. Okay, good stuff. Where can I get this? You know. Next item would be customer relationships. Customer relationships basically describe the nature of your relationship. You want to understand that, you want to understand how to acquire your customers. How do you retain them? How do you grow your customers? Sounds very much like you know, keeping a relationship, right, guys? So here, in this sense, that when you want to acquire your customers, you need to know what is the one thing that makes them very interested in your product. Did you actually offer that value? Then once they tried your product, how do they stay? How do they want to keep using your product, right? And how do you grow your customers? Like, how do you expand more than that? Did they tell their friends? Did they communicate with other people and say, oh, you know what, recommend, rating, you know, like people would like it. So this is very simple. This morning, you know, when you go into the shower, you look at your shampoo, it's the same shampoo brand that you've been using for the past 4 or 5 years. Yep, you're definitely acquired, you're definitely a retainer. And yeah. Think about how many times you recommend your friends, hey, you got to try this shampoo, it smells so good, makes my hair so soft, right? So that's the kind of thing that you want to look at, yeah? So there's four type of themes for customer relationship. One of it is that type of relationship. Some relationships are very, I would say, loyal. In this case is that there's different types. One of it is that if you go to the gym, then the type of relationship is that more towards subscription, okay? In some cases, if you go to the supermarket, you purchase, for example, I just want to get any type of cheese. Yeah, I want to make pizzas. So the cheese, okay, I usually go for this brand. But if it's not, then okay, maybe I try some other brand. So in a way that it's in a way it's like a one-off as well. But if you're loyal to a product, then that's that. It already established that you're an advocate for it. Yeah. Bond established. It takes a long time to get a bond. Yeah. Some bonds would take years. Some bonds would be instant when people like, oh my God, I got to change my brand. I don't want to use this shampoo. I got to try some other things anymore. You know, like that's the kind of thing that you look at. So how strong is the advocacy for your product? Intimacy of customer relationship. This is very important because a lot of companies tend to forget this. Even if they're selling products that are, I would say, home products. I noticed this is a huge issue because, you know, nowadays people bake. During COVID, people bake, people cook. And the thing is, when they post up their food on social media, great, looks really nice. But the thing is, sometimes they don't respond very well. They don't respond on time. They don't respond within 24/7. To their customers' queries. Yeah, so you gotta be careful on that one. Try to take care and be much more proactive in that sense. The last one is relationship cycle. Try to understand, are you in the early stage of it? Are you in the middle stage where you're trying to understand the product better? Or are you already a pro at this product? And you can see that, okay, the customers tend to just, you know, basically advocate to other people, like, yo, you know what, try out this product, it's really good, it smells so nice, it tastes really good, and all those things. Yeah, so you got to identify which stage are you on. Each stage has its own challenges. All right, so I'm going to move forward from here. I hope it's all good. If you have any questions, just to remind everybody, pop it up in the chat, I'll answer them one by one after this. All right, let's talk about the revenue streams. It's very easy. How do you make money? How do you make money from your customers? Yeah. The outcome of it is that the choices you made for value proposition, this is basically that whatever that you've built up, this is the outcome. How sellable is your product? How interested are people in your product? Yeah. Should always be bigger than your cost, as per usual. Like if your cost is higher than your revenue, means something is wrong. You got to be careful and try to re-strategize. In the early stage of business, it's normal when you have high costs. Okay, don't be too scared for it. But you have to make sure that sales are always consistent. At least you're getting back your money. In a month, like say, if you have a cost of $3,000, you want to try to get back at least like $1,000 or $2,000. I know it's very tough in the early stage, but once it starts to pick up, okay, then you could make more money out of it. The last item is avoid orphan streams. Orphan streams are basically that if you come up with, say, maybe a product, and then there's another leading on product again after that, and it never ends, never ends. Some customers are not happy about it. So some models work, some models doesn't work that way. So imagine you go to the gym, right? And then people say, okay, you want to use the tools, the equipments, great. But okay, if you want to use this other thing, you got to pay. You want to use this other thing, you got to pay. Some customers don't like that. This is very popular, and I know all of you guys are very young. I know all of you guys, but I think the boys play a lot of games. I think for the girls as well nowadays, I see a lot of girl gamers. So think about this. So when you play games, yeah, maybe like Fortnite, right? Nowadays you can get skins and then you just want to get what you wanted. But then there's a new one, then there's a new one and there's a new one. It's good. You make more revenue streams. But in some cases, depends on the product. If it's not suitable, then try to omit it. People like final products in that sense. Yeah. Wow, guys, we're using Fortnite as an example. Okay. Orphan streams, how do they look like? How do we visualize them? So for example, Fortnite, right? Or maybe using Google in this case, yeah, for educational purposes. So value proposition, let's think about Google. Google, anyone can search, any users can utilize it. Anyone can basically, the revenue stream is that it's free. But the thing is, if you want to start promoting on Google Ads, Google AdWords, you want to promote your business, you got to start paying. And that's how Google makes money. Amazon makes money. Access to large audience, advertisers, advertising fee. Facebook does it. Now it's called Meta, right? So it's basically the same thing here. One other thing as well I want to share is, like I said about Fortnite, anyone can play the game. You don't have to pay. You just have a laptop. You can play and, you know, click, click, click. Then suddenly they promote, oh, you want to get a new skin, right? Or maybe you want to get a new feature, then you got to pay. Okay, again, I'm not saying that it's wrong. In fact, this is one of the ways to be creative how you make money. The only reason why it's put avoid orphan revenue streams is because it only works on specific industries and specific business models. So you don't have to do it every time, okay? So for example, if you were to use shampoo, right? Shampoo would be like, okay, just get a shampoo. Okay, but to get a shampoo, you only get this amount. Then you want to get another amount. No one sells it that way. You want to get the final product, this specific size and frame. So let's pull it together. If you realize the things that we talked about, value proposition, customer relationships, channels and customer segments and revenue streams, all of these are in the greens. We focus on the right side of things and everything goes down together. These are all things that should relate together within this component. Let's talk about the left side. Let's talk about the resources, key activities and key partners, and lastly, cost structure. Key resources. What is the most important things that you need to have for your business model to work? Is it tangible? Is it intangible? Yeah, so the question is that you need to know what is the bare minimum for your business to operate. Okay, so let's see. Let's think about this. If you want to start an ice cream parlor, if you want to start an ice cream shop, yeah, so you got to get the ingredients. You're going to perhaps, if you're going to do it at home, okay, fine, great. But you need a fridge. You need to get the equipment to make the ice cream. Yep. Same thing if you're talking about IT. If you're going to kick off a startup in tech, you gotta first get a laptop. If you don't have a laptop, you can't start anything. But nowadays, people are trying to challenge the norm. You can now code from your phone. I'm like, wow, impressive stuff, right? A lot of people are very creative and they're coming up with a lot of things like these. So the world is, again, is your oyster. Feel free to explore. But let's talk about key resource. These are the first things you cannot do without, absolute essentials. It could be maybe your shop. You need a physical shop. Do you need it now, especially during COVID? Maybe not. Yeah, so think about it in deeper. So when you come up with your business idea for BIMP-EAGA, make sure that you know these are things we cannot do without. You have to vote sometimes with your peers. Some of your peers will say, we don't need this, but you were like, oh, we really need it, man. We need the new laptop. Do you really need it? Or is it for gaming? You know, it could be that. So think about it deeper. It is. What are the most important things you need to be able to perform in order for your business model to work? Where do you really need to excel? So the key activities consist of your day-to-day. How does your day-to-day look like for your business operations? So let's think about it. We have an ice cream shop. In the morning, we wake up at 5, make ice cream. By the time it's 10, we got ice cream already. We can start selling by 10:30. Yeah. When do people start to purchase? Yeah, from 10:30, you can already do deliveries after that once there are orders. And that's how the business actually looks like. You see, there's like logistics you got to think of. You got to think about marketing, right? Second aspect of it. How do people know about your product? Put it up on social media or things like that. Let's think about anywhere.co. Something much more realistic. Yeah. So anywhere.co, we know now they're based in Singapore, but their day-to-day life is that they work from a co-working space. And the thing is that there were a team of, I believe it was a team of 5 people. It wasn't a really big team. Yep. But what's really cool is that they have a different set of expertise. One person is a finance, one person is really good in business, knows how to talk. Another person knows how to find all these places to travel. Some person knows how to maintain relationships. Some other person knows how to do marketing. So those are the kind of roles you got to understand. Please try to elaborate and be much more detailed in that. So think about this for you and your team. What is my role in the team? What are your roles in the team? And last item would be key partnerships. Key partnerships is that who are the people or your suppliers or partners that could help your business to grow? Okay, think about your business model. Do they really need to be part of it? Is it relevant? But making sure that each time you have a business partner, you have a win-win situation, a win-win partnership. So you benefit them, they benefit you. As people say, you scratch my back, I scratch yours. And the thing is, we want to make sure that everyone is winning. In some cases, some business would be that, okay, one person wins now, but some other partners win another time, you know, in the long run could be. So again, this is depending on how you negotiate with your partners. If we were going to start that ice cream company, you got to find who are the suppliers of the milk, of the ingredients, of the machines and things like that. Now, same thing, you think about anywhere.co. Do you think they have very few partners? No, they have a lot of partners across the world. So remember when I said like they have over 20 partners across different countries, and that's very, you know, very impressive numbers. So this is the kind of partners that you need to have, that kind of partnership. Yeah, and they win. They get all the partners that they have. It could be accommodation, and basically anywhere.co secured customers for the accommodation or the hotels. Some basically are locals who start activities and, you know, recreational activities and stuff. They partner with them and, okay, we supply you all these people. Help us create an itinerary or something like that. Very fun stuff. The cost structure, the last part of it. All of these are the costs that you need to operate your business in your day to day. Okay, so you got to list it down. What are the things you need to spend on? What are your activities that would require money or cost? What are the partnerships that might require some funds as well to spend? And the most important part of it is that making sure it's always smaller than your revenue. You don't want a high cost and you can't operate, you can't sustain your business, and basically within a year it could burn out, it could die. You don't want to do that. You want to have a survival, a really strong and capable company as well. So making sure, if you're able to sustain yourself in the in 1 or 2 years, that's already good news, you know. Some investors really like that, you know. And but once you start to see, okay, we're gonna get more people and we're starting to pay and pay, and that is gonna be a huge challenge. But at the same time, it's not impossible. A lot of people have succeeded as well. So yeah, try to manage your finance as much as you can from the start. I highly recommend that. Most cases is that it will comprise together into like a pillar: key partners, key activities, key resources, and cost structure. All of these will relate with one another. Trust me on this one. I've seen quite a number of it, and people usually forget that, okay, we need key partners. Okay, it doesn't reflect on the cost structure. Yeah, so you got to understand what are the roles of the key partners, what are the roles, what are the activities that they are offering for you, what are the resources, and what are the cost structure as well. Yeah, hope this is okay for all of you. If you have any more questions, just ask me in the chat. I'll answer them again. Just remind everybody after finishing my slides on this one. We're going to explore the business model canvas. Some of the rules is that we're, as I said, usually we normally do it in the physical class, but here we're gonna use very similar to how it was yesterday. So we're gonna be using the Jamboard as yesterday. We'll be using some post-its, color coding, and things like that. All right, but we're gonna keep it open as much as we can on anywhere.co. After that, I will try to pitch a little so you guys can see what kind of things that I'm actually pitching about. So some of the questions for pitching is that, firstly, what do you like in the business model? In this one, we're going to talk about anywhere.co. Secondly is, what is unclear or hard to understand? Third is, what is the business model missing? What is the thing that the mechanism or the information is missing? What could be strengthened? Yeah, so bear in mind, these are some of the questions you should always consider, and some of it would be answered by your team, not just you. All right, so we're going to go into that, into the business model canvas. But before I go into that, so just waiting for the queue for Shu, my colleague. So there's some other business model examples. For example, here is Cropital. As you guys can see, they have like a lot of points here. But the reds, yeah, these are the ones they put into priority and things like that. Sorry, the yellows are the ones in priority, but the ones in the reds are the information that would actually boost up some of their business details and things like that. I'm not going to go into one by one of it, but at least for you guys to browse down on this one. Yeah, so perhaps Cropital is like one of the startups that focus on farmers and farming, and they want to make sure that people are able to fund farmers and basically grow and make money. In this case, it's also an investment platform. And supporting farmers, sales, millennials, micro investors, and things like that. There's also Bayani Brew, okay, so basically talking about making beverage. Yeah, so perhaps there would be like their partners are people who are bottling it, printing it, transporting, exchange, or health conscious people, you know, who can help, maybe researchers perhaps as well. In some cases, they also look at, maybe selling it at retail stores and things like that. See some channels here that they put. I'm just browsing it through so you guys can see. I'm not going to go into one by one because, again, this is just one of the examples that we have. Let me see. There's also revenue streams. Some of them are very creative. Holiday packs. Christmas is coming. New Year is coming. Make those promotions, right? Making sure everything has to go. Direct home sales, wholesale to retail outlets. Yeah, so these are some of the few things that they are able to do. Cost structure, price of the raw materials, bottling and processing, sales and marketing. If you guys can realize, all of these components relates to here, cost structure. Same thing as here, who is gonna purchase them? Yeah, basically some consumers would go for home sales, some of them would go for holiday packs and things like that. Right, yeah. So yeah, we're gonna go back. I'm gonna just quickly go to the chat box and see if there is any question. Yeah, I can see someone is excited when I mention Fortnite. You should know the list of games I play at home. Yep. Okay. So another question would be, is this the same as freemium? Now, okay, my colleague has answered, Bobby has answered. Freemium is a huge umbrella term for free for all, but some will pay. Yeah. So freemium, basically, it opens the door for people to use it for free. Then you want to have more things add on, then you need to start paying additional things. One of the most easily put as an example is things you already use now. For example, Google. You've never paid Google in your whole life until you realize that you needed more storage for your Google Drive, right? So that's one example. Another one would be, let me see. What's that thing called? Dropbox. Oh yeah, Dropbox. It still exists, yeah? So Dropbox. So Dropbox as well, back in the days, right? People use it more to store and for people to download files, if you're a stranger, you could access it. Then they have like a limited amount of storage as well. I believe Apple nowadays is also looking into it. You know, Apple Cloud and things like that. Yeah. Okay, so I hope that answers your question, Nicholas. There's no other question. I guess that's fine. Let me proceed to the, we're going to talk about the Jamboard again. Yep. Okay, before I go, there's another question by Wazif. What do we do if the value for the business in detriment for the value of other people? For example, AI technology, which improves security and safety, affects the job of security guards. Definitely didn't get that example from the drama startup. Great. Okay, that's a very cool question. Okay. So let's put it into perspective, right? The world is changing, and one, of course, the speakers are from the past 2 days. They talk about IR 4.0, basically. And the thing is that when people talk about Industry Revolution 4.0, we are thinking about changing or adapting the future of work. It means that some security guards might have to be replaced. But the thing is, what do we do with them, right? So it's not all industries that they have to adapt this. Some brick and mortar business still is relevant where they need a physical guard. So I don't foresee that people would fully be replaced yet. I know technologists will say, oh, you know what? That's not true. You know, everyone's going to be replaced by, you know, but who's going to live then? Who is, you know, going to be sorting out all those things? Still us humans, right? So I think that in a sense, I watch quite a few sci-fi movies and it's very exciting. At the same time, can be very scary as well. Yeah. So the thing is, a lot of social enterprise are trying to solve this issue. You want to create more jobs for people, but the world is also going towards that direction where jobs are being replaced. So there is a fine line in between. That is a really good question, and I really like it, actually. Thanks very much for it, Wazif. So this is my perception on it, yeah? I definitely like to hear a lot of these thoughts as well. To be honest, I read quite a number of things on this one. So let me proceed. Yeah, I hope that answers your question, by the way. Okay, I have one more question. What do you think will be the business opportunities that will come with the metaverse? Oof, this is a good question. Okay, I'm not really into the metaverse yet at this moment. I'm very curious how that's going to look out. But the thing is, the technology world, right, is very... it's open, anyone can access. And nowadays, when people talk about data, it's either you own it or, you know, used to be there's that intellectual property where people say, my data and it's mine. And like, for example, Apple, they want to make sure all your personal information and basically your details are preserved, right? And the thing is, when people start to get easy access, that whole wall, your information could be used by other people and you do not even have the knowledge for it. Yeah, so that's a bit scary. So I would say that if you talk about business opportunities, there's no limitations to it. Nowadays, people are talking about NFTs, try to look into it. People are talking about cryptocurrency and things like that. I believe in America, it's one of the leading countries about this. You talk about Elon Musk, very innovative person. Yeah, and the thing is, the world to explore for ICT is just huge. At this moment, it's like going to space, as Elon has put it as well. I think as a start, since we're looking at BIMP-EAGA, I believe in Malaysia, there's a community for crypto already and blockchain. I know quite a number of them. In the Philippines, I saw a lot of it as well, and Indonesia as well. So I think the different countries have already started to scale up on this one. I do look forward for Brunei, however. Like, I hope that there are more activity in this. It's been really exciting reading it outside of Brunei, but I want to see things in here as well. Like, how does it challenge the economy? What kind of things it could solve and things like that. So I like these things. Yep. So thank you very much for the question. I hope it answers your question, yeah? Faizul? Let me proceed to the next part, right? We're going to talk about the business model canvas. We're going to use it. So let's think about it. I'm going to do what we did past 2 days. You guys are just going to sit down and just type your answers, and I'll put it here up on the business model canvas. So let's think about anywhere.co. Just to refresh, Shu, can we go back to the first page of the Jamboard? First page of the Jamboard, remember, okay? All of these components are the same things that we already have inside the business model canvas, almost, except 4 items, okay? But remember, what is anywhere.co? It's basically a startup that helps you customize your travel. It focuses on a specific demographic. There's children, women, students, female travelers, budget travelers, family, and things like that. Some of the channels we look at is Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, content marketing. Unfair advantage is that it's a one-stop for customized travel, 24/7 assurance, over 50 partners across 20 countries. Very impressive stuff. It's a solution people provide for itinerary for travels, HSC assessments pre-travel, 24/7 support. Cost structure, we're spending on site costs, 24/7 operators, training for people. We're also looking at revenue streams. There's travel packages, ads, commission fees from community partners, and travel packages and things like that. Yeah, and the unique value proposition, I think it's right there. Key metrics, we will not be using it later, but we'll work in it with a key resource, things we cannot do without. Okay, so let's go to the next page, Shu. Yeah, basically, are we actually solving the problem? We can see some of this. Again, I'm just giving you guys a bit of refresher, yeah? Yep, some of the things will be some of the things we want to do. Technology, policies, insurance, 24/7 assistance, policemen, protective gears and tools, practices, emergency information and things like that. Pre-travel research, that's very important. And lastly, tour guides, when you have partnerships. This is important, yeah? Remember the partnerships we have here? These are some of the things we will have, we can put on the key resource. So remember, we have embassy, we have hotline for travelers, tour guides, money exchanges, approved accommodations, things like that. Let's go into the next one, Shu. So here we try to narrow it down, focus on apps, insurance, assistance, pre-travel research, protective gears, you can purchase all of these, and emergency information, that's all we need. Tour guides, hotline for travelers, trusted money exchange, and customer friendly, there's also solo travelers, female travelers, newlyweds, and all those things. Okay, so just a few of it. Yep. Things to consider, price, budget, UI, UX, reliability. The process, we're not going to be using it for this time, but remember, we will be using this specifically for key activities. Okay, so don't forget this either. So we want to make sure that someone is managing the website or maybe the app. Yeah, someone is sorting out the finances for the payment gateway. Someone is handling the packages, travel destinations, and things like that. Insurance, 24/7 assistance. Someone is on operating, hotline bling. We talk about it. And someone's providing the protective tools. Who's going to do it? Is it your team? Or is it going to be basically your partners? Okay, so we're going to move on. We're going to start writing it down. Okay. So let me open that as well. Okay, let's talk about the first item right here. The first item, who are our key partners? Let's think about it for a moment, guys. Okay, let's start typing it down. Okay, key partners, I would assume that we will have. Feel free to put in some names, yeah? Hotels and things like that if you really know. Or Airbnb maybe, yeah? Hotels. Other partners that we will have. I would foresee that insurance. Insurance partners. Okay. How about locally? Do we have people who could, let me see, who could suggest different places? So local partners, right? Local partners. Right. Okay. Faisal, you mentioned security companies. You might need to be very much specific. By security, remember, we're talking about anywhere.co. Do we need it? Do we need that kind of security? What type of security? You might need to be slightly in depth. Yep. Service provider. I think, Muizuddin, you might need to go a bit in depth as well. By service, what is it? Is it like activity or what? It's still very general. Remember, we are trying to narrow it down. And similarly with Shazwana as well, Shazana, try to go into much more deeper. Tourism, what is tourism? Let's make it much more deeper. Airlines, I can accept that one. All right, airlines, airline partners. Okay, so Faisal mentioned about to provide the SOS distress call signal. Great, okay, good to know. So we can put SOS distress, SOS security suppliers then, right? SOS security items. Yep. Sky scanner, that's a cool one. Flight search. Yeah, why not, right? Helps you make it. Yep. Sky scanner for flight. Also want to look at transportation agency. Yeah. Transportation or logistics. Restaurants, food. Restaurants. Okay, operators. I like that one. It's already good. See, we're now narrowing it down. We have to be on the same page on this one. Travel agencies. I like that. We got the right people here. Technology services. Okay, technology services. What do we need for that one? Is it the coders? Is it the specialists? I'm going to put specialist for that, yeah, because yeah, we will need that. Technology specialists. Okay. I think we have quite a few already, right? That's a lot of key partners. Let's stop that for a bit. Yeah. I think the coders can go into technology specialists. Let's let me expand that one. Technology specialists, app developers. Yep, app developers and coders are, yep, within that frame. So I'm just going to keep it simple first. Let's move on. Key activities. What is our day-to-day like? Yep. Someone mentioned, okay, handicraft. Let me just write it down. Craft shop, Shu, you can put handicraft in partners. Yep, I think we're going to move on after this. Let's focus on key activities. What is the key activities? What is our day-to-day like? Yeah. So this one can be a bit descriptive. Let's talk about let me see. Operating, calling. Operators, 24/7 assistance. So remember, what are the roles of the partners? Some of them also do basically contacting with hotels, right? Managing logistics. Managing logistics, such as hotels, restaurants, food. Okay, I see customer service. Yep. Service, good. Financial and budget planning. Yep, financial, definitely. Remember, we're all anywhere.co, so we gotta keep it within this one, yeah? Okay, what other things do we look at? Remember, we have a website. What do they do? Maintain website, right? Maintaining website, app if needed. Remember when I told you guys how anywhere.co operates? So if you guys have never tried it down, it's okay. You guys can try it once the pandemic is over. So what happens is that when you go to the website, you will receive, once you pay for everything, you'll receive a coupon, and that coupon you will receive after that a letter. That letter will have all your flight details on the specific date and everything. So who's going to do that? So your team also has to do packaging of it. So itinerary, remember, we want itinerary. Itinerary, preparations. Okay, someone also says about keeping track of news. Keep track, keep up to trends. Keep up with trends. Gonna write it that way. Yep, data and yep, security defenses. Gonna remind everybody, we're not fully secured. I mean, okay, we are a secure, we want to make sure the traveling experience is secure, but remember, we're also a company that focus on traveling for for travelers, yeah. So remember, who is our customer? We should still consider that one as well. Promotion, good. Marketing and promotion. Right, I'm going to stop there, okay? We have a lot of information there. So for that one, we're going to stop there. Let's think. Next one, key resources. What kind of things do we need? Key resources. We need operators, guys, to call 24/7. Okay? Let's think about tangible and intangible things. Okay? Itinerary. Itinerary. Basically letters, right? Or papers, stationaries and things like that. Yep. So that's going to go under key resources. Okay, website itself, great. I think management of staff, Nicholas, that's gonna go under activity. Yep, so we're gonna put it there. Management of staff. But we're gonna move on, yeah. We're moving on to key resources. So to take note, guys. Okay, let me see. So managing staff, that's gonna go under key activities, yeah, Shu. Okay. So let's proceed. This is already great. A lot of information. I like it. Thanks very much, everybody, for contributing. So key resources. What are the things we want to have? What things do we need? Someone says guide. Yes, we need updated guides every time. Some other resources. Okay, cash might be a bit too broad. Sorry, Nora Lifa, might be a bit too broad. Okay, but let's think about deeper about it, right? Perhaps I will take it. We'll take it that we need funds for travels, right? So making sure that money is always in. So financing, because travel is not cheap. Because sometimes financing, you might need to pay first in advance to book, say, maybe the activities with your partners, right? So I will take that. Okay, raw materials. You might need to be very specific. Remember, we are anywhere.co. Do they need raw materials? Do we need metal? Do we need what kind of raw materials? Try to elaborate that one. Yeah, Safwan? Okay, Naziba, capital. Capital, yes. I think that's pretty straightforward. You need capital, yeah. Repairs and backups. Okay. What are we repairing and what are we backing up? Is it the, again, we're, remember, anywhere.co is basically the mediator. We don't own any of the hotels. We don't own any of the facilities, okay? Okay. All right. I see place. Okay, let's put it this way. We need our key resource, and that is not something we could replace, which is our partnerships. That is something intangible. So we should put partnerships in there. Okay. Now, I see, okay, Norashikin, you mentioned contact as feature on the website. I think that's a feature. It's not a key resource, unfortunately, in this case, I would say, but you can try again, because I think contact us in the feature, I think that already falls under website. If it's a feature in the website, we will generalize it as website. Okay, good one. Okay, let me see. The key resources, customer accommodation. Yep, I think that falls under partnership. Okay, so travel accommodation partners. I will take that one. Okay. I see there's also people. Number of travelers registered. Okay. So these are the, this would be falling into customer segments, actually, Naziba, and for real, I think. Yeah. So we will talk about that a bit later. Yeah, so hold on to that one first, right? Okay, it's starting to flow, fill up for key resource. I want to focus on value proposition right now. Okay, let's zoom a little bit. What does value proposition actually mean? Let's think about this. What value do we deliver to the customers? Which one of our customers' problems are we helping to solve? What bundles and products and service are we offering to each customer segment? And which customer segment needs are we satisfying? Remember the prize, the gift that I was talking about just now, and your customers? So we want to make sure that they're happy, right? So before that, I'm going to pause value proposition. I want us to talk about the cost structure first. We're going to go down first, right? We're going to go to cost structure. We're going to finish up on the things on the left first. Remember, it was in two parts, in two quadrants. Cost structure, what are we spending on? So here we have important costs. Key resources are mostly expensive. Our key activities expensive as well. So let's start to list it down. So what are we actually spending for key resources? What are we spending for key activities? Website, good. Website costs, right? Advertisements, great. Okay, loans. Loans. Okay, perhaps loans. I'm trying to think more towards the day-to-day. So I think some funds for, if you have to pay for any advance, right? Finance for advance travelers. Okay. Machinery. Okay, we might need to be specific with machinery. Okay, I think machinery, we're gonna be talking about things like laptops, right? Your tools, right? Office equipments. I think that's what we can put it as. Machinery. Okay, I see. Okay, employees, good. I also want to put in, remember, we have operators. Yeah, internet, Wi-Fi. Okay, Wi-Fi, utilities might, okay, maybe for the office, right? Office utilities, I would take that one. Remember, we don't own the facilities, yeah? We don't own any of it. We are basically a mediator in the middle, yeah? Office rental, great. Okay. I see a lot of it now. Good stuff, guys. Well done. We're almost there. Trainings. Finally, someone says training. That was one of the things even I forgot just now. When we were browsing it through, I was like, okay, we need training as well. What's missing? We are 24/7 assistants. We need telephones, guys, or mobile phones, network coverage, an iPhone 13 plus. Is that what it's called? iPhone 13 yeah. plus, right? That's the best one, right? iPhone 13 plus max. Yeah. Okay. Thanks for correcting me. iPhone 13 Pro Max. Yeah, we got that one right. Okay. Someone is crying about the iPhone. It's okay. I can cry with you too. I'm still using a Huawei. I haven't upgraded my phone. Okay. Royalty. Patents. Oh, definitely. Because this is a really cool, unique business. We gotta be careful on that one. Royalty and patents. Nice one. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I saw tears. We're not gonna put tears into cost. So sorry. Can keep crying. Okay, let's move forward. Yeah, from here. This is really good stuff. Okay, let me see. Let's talk about customer segments right here. So we have customer segments in general. I wanna really make it within time as well. Customer segments, let's refresh what we had. I heard an audio behind. Okay. Anyways, customer segments, travelers. Who are we supporting? Young female travelers, right? It was one of the things that they really look at, because Zelia herself was a female traveler. She wants to travel in peace. Okay, female travelers, students with budgets, right? Let me see, family. These are all the things that we already have from yesterday, so it's definitely nothing new. Researchers, I remember someone mentioned researchers yesterday. Let me see, what else do we have? Okay, I can see it here. Bloggers. Newlyweds, okay, newlyweds, vloggers. Yeah, from yesterday. Vloggers, newlyweds. Okay, influencers and vloggers. I think they could be together. Hipsters, yeah. There's new terms every time. Interns, I'm going to put them as students, so that's okay. Yeah, businessmen, right? Businessmen and women. Business people, I'll put them as business people. Celebrities, important people, I'm going to put them under, basically, they should be, yeah, probably under vloggers, yeah? Yep. Going to categorize them. So expatriate, okay, in this case, because we are not bounded by country, not bounded by your nationality, I would eliminate, I think, expatriate, because essentially anyone could travel. Yeah, so that's how it's really cool. Travel loggers. Okay, thanks, Bobby. Travel loggers are backpackers who blogs. That's a good one. Okay, so that's like travel loggers, bloggers. Yeah. Okay, I see teachers. Teachers, I think we can put them under, okay, students and teachers. Let's change that to students and teachers. Yeah, right? Of course, teachers also need breaks. We also need to relax and unwind with our family and friends. So millennials would be another demographic. Okay, Shu, can we quickly zoom into customer segments? Okay, let's read on the top. For whom are we creating value? Who are our most important characters? So I want to give you guys one very important tip. When you talk about family, when you talk about travelers, when you talk about teachers and students, one of the things you need to look into is that you need to be very specific. You could be gender specific, you could be age specific, you could be also maybe maybe their salary and earnings. You could talk about that as well. So their amount of capability for them to pay for something is also very important. Yeah. Okay. Oh, I like this one. Someone mentioned socialita. I think that means, yeah, socialites, right? Okay. So we're going to put that and let's move on. Let's talk about the next item. Okay. We're going to talk about channels first before we go into customer relationships. I want to talk about channels because this is the easiest to do. Where or what platforms shall we be on, everybody? Facebook. Okay, my page is reloading. Okay, we want Facebook, we want Instagram. Okay, Facebook, IG. I think you're typing already. Okay, it's okay, let me do that. I'll type it down for you. Okay, Facebook, Instagram, someone mentions Meta. TikTok, maybe, yeah. I think they might, I don't know if actually, yeah, they could be there, yeah. Anyway, Roku could be there. Meta, might be interesting. Trivago. Okay, Trivago may, they could be promoted there on an ad. Yeah, so we can go. Reddit. Well, definitely, I think there's a lot of traction there. People could give recommendations there. Yeah, why not? Reddit, Reddit accounts. Instagram sponsor, yeah, that's on Instagram, Facebook. We got that ready, guys. Wikipedia, I think that's more information. Discord, possible. There might be a community starting from there. Again, we're talking about the business about travel, right? So people like to travel and see a lot of places. Yep. Okay. Right, my Jamboard is refreshing again. There's a bit of a lag on my side. So sorry about that, guys. Radios and billboards. Yeah, maybe. I think that will be good to see. Yeah, probably in Singapore or somewhere, everywhere. WhatsApp and Telegram. Okay, now we're going to stop there. Yeah, there's so many ads. There's so many things coming in as well. I saw YouTube ads. Okay, YouTube. I'll put YouTube. You can see the visual of it, like traveling and everything. Okay, we're going to stop there. Now, we're going to consider which among all of these, right, all these channels that they actually use and feel that they're not wasting time and money. Because what if there's no traction on this specific, you know, pages? So you got to be more careful. I'm not going to make a highlight or put priority into it yet, but you got to consider, you got to think, do they need it on Trivago? Do they need it on radio and billboards? Or are they happy just going virtual? Okay, so that's something for you to think about, right? Now, we're going to move forward. We have three more items to look into, and we're on time. Very good. Thank you very much, guys. I really appreciate your cooperation for this. This is really good. I like how things that we are sharing so many things. Okay, let's talk about customer relationships. So, Shu, we're zooming in that. Thank you very much. What type of relationship does each of our customer segments expect us to establish and maintain with them? Which one have we established? How are they integrated with the rest of our business model, and how costly are they? We're not going to talk about cost at this moment. We're going to talk about what type of relationship. So remember, if you've traveled so many times before with anywhere.co, we have returning customers. For this part, there's not many answers. It's only just at least like 3 to 4, just a very few, okay? But feel free to just come in and jump and share your thoughts on this one. It's always fine to get more ideas. So one of it would be returning customers, yeah? Maybe like just now, someone said about vloggers, right? So that's a kind of like people say affiliates, right? It's... Yep. I remember someone talked about subscription yesterday. I think for this model, they may not have it yet. But again, we don't want to omit it, right? Who knows, they might go into subscription. Subscription, not to travel, more like what are the best You know, when you travel for Brunei Airlines, we have like a mileage. I think this applies to almost anywhere as well. You know, so that's the kind of promotion people like to look forward to. Yeah, like a membership, I think most, like even Trivago has it as well. You sign up, you get like free promos and stuff like that. Great stuff. Sponsors, promotion, yeah, promotion, sponsors. Yep, loyalty points. Those are already going into, let me see, those are actually going to perhaps key resources. They could go into that. Trusted investors might be a bit different because we're focused on customers. Investors are people who fund your business. They're not the one investing. They're not your customers, yeah? So they're the ones supporting your business. They're the ones that are paying you to grow your business, okay? Here, you want to make sure people, the customers who would actually spend and use your package. Remember that one, yeah? Okay, thank you very much, Safwan. That's a very good one still. Let's dig deeper into this one. Let's go into value proposition. Okay, someone said about customer reviews and comments. I will put that as customer ratings. Yep, so feedbacks and things like that, a personal one-to-one. Actually, one-to-one, that's a very good one already because we have a 24/7, right? So if you have a dedicated customer, one-to-one, dedicated with your officer, dedicated one-to-one customer to agent, to operator. It's a very important one. It's like when you go to the gym, you have a trainer, the coach will focus only on you. They don't go to other person and like, hey, do 10 push-ups. No, it's actually just for you. You got to do the 10 push-ups, right? Okay, so let's go into value propositions. Shoot. Let's zoom in a little bit. What we want is that we want to give value, basically deliver the value to the customers. Which one of our customer problems are we helping them to solve? What bundles of product and services are we offering to each customer segments? And which customer segments needs are we satisfying? All right, so I'm putting a pause just now because we need to know who are our customer segments. We need to be very clear. So I'm going to write down one answer and you guys are going to help me out on it. So we want to have packages. Basically, remember, we want to have a customized travel itinerary. It's very similar to the ones that we had before, remember? Yep. So we want a customized travel itinerary. We want very budget packages, travel packages, budget-friendly travel packages. Okay. We want to have safety as a priority during travel. Yep. Offer travel recommendations. We make it fun. Offer awesome travel recommendation. For customers, specific customer needs. Okay, so remember we had on our previous one before, on the previous page, we had, let me see, so you can stay on that page. On the previous page, we had anyone can go anywhere, designated trips with recommended activities and tailor-made destination. Yep, we also have think less, travel more. Okay. Think less, travel more. Okay, someone mentioned about best digital security deals and payoffs. Okay, we got to be careful again. We got to think about travels here. So best travel digital, okay, best travel, retype that one, yeah? Best travel. Okay. Best travel and security deals. Okay. We also want to have great customer service and quality. Great customer service and quality. Okay, I see your travel partner. That's a good catchy one. Your, maybe your only travel partner, right? So it sounds really cool. Your travel partner, I'll just put it there. Okay, I see someone typing point systems for discounts or gifts. Okay. Loyalty points, right? Loyalty points for this travel discounts and gifts. Thank you very much, everyone. We're almost there. Okay, let's look at the last one. The last one, we're going to talk about revenue streams. Shu, we're going to refresh our head first. We're going to go into the lean canvas and see what did we list there. Okay, so remember, these are what you guys wrote. Yeah, we're going to zoom a bit there. We have traveling tips. We have travel packages, commission fees, community partners, ads. Can we zoom a little bit, Shu, at the bottom? Thank you. Merchandise, there's royalty from partners, souvenirs, subscription, and membership. Okay, so remember these, guys. Take a note of these. And we're going to write them there and see if you guys have any new ideas or any new revenue streams. Okay, so so we're going to copy them and we're going to paste them in page 4. Do that, right? Can copy. Yeah. Okay, got it. No worries. It's okay. I'll say it for you. Yeah. And I think the team are, everyone's going to write it. Everyone's going to contribute as well. So ads. Yeah, I'll say it for you. Yep, so there's ads, travel packages. I'll type it down for you, yeah? Yeah, I need to read it actually, yeah. So travel packages, okay, ads, commissions, royalties, merchandise, okay? If you guys have any more new revenue streams, feel free to jump in for this one, yeah? There's also souvenirs. We also want to put in souvenirs. Okay. Let me see. There's also one more. What am I missing? Subscription and membership fees. Yeah, I think those are good enough already. Don't see any activity on the chat box, so I think everyone's okay with this one, yeah? You guys are good. Give me a thumbs up. Great, nice one, guys. Wow, that's a lot. Thank you very much, guys. Really like it. Okay, let's look into this. Let's digest this a little bit. All right. Okay, well, my colleague is doing the sorting now. As you guys can see, this is all the information that we come up with in the past 2-3 days. And the thing is, all this information are relevant. Like, you need to see that, okay, we want to grow the business. We want to take it further. We got to refine it at some point, but we need to know what are we really providing. So that's why when I question this now, like things like security, we got to be much more specific. When you talk about finance and investors, okay, at what point, at what capacity? So some partners would require investors, but in this case for them, for the key partners for anywhere.co, they're very independent. Like, you don't need investors every time. Okay, so investors are good, but I think in some cases it would be not always, but certain times. Yep, but still, I really like the idea. I would like to get invested, right? So, okay, so the next step is that what you need to do, once you have all this information, you need to compile them, make it into a report. And that is what you essentially call a business plan. You can put this one page as well, but the thing is, once you have all this information, you can start writing. You talk about hotels, what are the rates? What are the costs? Who are they? You got to list down the names. This is a good head start for you to already compile and get a lot of information. So I want to see, you know, sometime in the future, when you guys write your own business plan, it's going to be at least like, I've seen some business plan which are 5 pages, some of them are even 10, some of them are even 50, some are, of course, if you talk about corporates, they're like 200, 3,000, yep, 3,000 guys. And the thing is, some of them is include like laws and legals and a lot of like photos and things like that, just to make sure that the book is as informative as possible. So that's something I really encourage you guys to do. No pressure. To be honest, if you are able to do like 5 to 10 pages, that's a good start already. Okay, so now I'm gonna do a very quick one. One important part about writing a business model and after you prepared everything is that you gotta know how to pitch, okay? Is where you wanna ask investors. So that's where your investors come into place. Let's think of a scenario right now, okay? I am one of the co-founders of Anywhere.co and I wanna get more investors. I want to get more funds. Okay, let's think about that. And the thing is, I know how much I'm asking for. We're gonna ask for at least 50,000. Okay, that's a in the investment world, it's a big amount, but of course, depends on the type of business. It may be small, it may be big, but we're gonna make it simple. 50,000. Now, assuming all the figures are my investors right now. Yeah, we're not. I'm basically Anywhere.co. All of you are my investors. You guys are going to judge me. Okay. So how I'm going to do it is that I'm going to prepare my slides. A slide is going to comprise of at least like 10 pages. Some cases it would be 20 pages. And what's going to happen is that you're going to go through each slide, pitch about your idea, your product, your project. And in some cases, you also will need to see, okay, the relevance of it. You need to put finance, information, and things like that. Yeah. So a bit of a run through. Most pitching varies from 3 to 5 minutes if it's like just a small competition. Bigger ones could go up to 30 to 20 minutes. Yep. But if you really go into detail with a huge partner, it can go even up to 1 hour, fairly speaking. So look at the number of key partners that we have. We want to pitch this to travel agencies. We want to pitch this to hotels. How do they know that we are legit? How do they know that we are that they can have confidence in our product? So we got to work on that one. Okay, so if you have the experience of public speaking, that's really good. That would help you in your journey. But if you guys are introverted like me, you guys might not believe that I'm an introvert. I am actually an introvert. But yeah, basically you just gotta think. If you're gonna be working, you're gonna just switch on the game. You know, you just gotta switch on the game and you just go. It's only 5-10 minutes, right? So let me do this. Good morning, everyone. My name is Afiq Muhammad, and I am representing Anywhere.co. So for today, I am very excited to show that we have a very cool business. Our business is focusing mostly on a customized travel itinerary. We help you to travel anywhere. If you're from Singapore, you can find a flight. If you're from Brunei, Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, you're just like us. You can go anywhere. You want to go to Europe next week? We'll help you out. We'll sort it out for you. So what's so great about us is that we have basically, we want to make sure that you think less and travel more. So what we offer to you is that we offer you travel packages. If you're a budget conscious traveler, we can find a very suitable budget package for you. If you consider that, okay, maybe you want to bring your friends and all of you guys are girls. Yeah, we have the 24/7 contact if you need any support. And also we know the locals. So if you think that perhaps, you know, maybe you're on a different level, you're a vlogger, we can bring you to all the hot places and you'll be the first to try it out. How cool is that, right? So to make you be sure about us is that we have a lot of partners across 20 countries, all right? So we have 50 partners at this moment. We have hotels. They also comprise of travel agencies. We work and partner with the local tour guides, We also partner with the airlines. So far, we've partners with partner at least with five. And this is between the BIMP-EAGA and Singapore, and it's really fun. Our revenue is XXX. I'm not going to mention how much. Our cost currently is around, assuming, 10K. Most of our costs are going into training of our officers to make sure that everyone is well-trained and well-spoken, and they know what are the whole situation in different countries. We want to make sure that everyone have a really good travel experience. The key resources that we have and we feel that we cannot do without is that we rely a lot on our website, and our website has a really good UI UX. The website also has the features, loyalty points, that I would say if you want to travel more, sign up for a membership and you instantly get the first login promotion. And that's very fun. Everyone likes promotions, right? Now, let me see. Our day-to-day in our office, we're a team of 10 people, very small team. But our day-to-day is mostly calling our partners and making sure we are up to date with new places, new trends, and hotspots that people have, our competitors can't get. So that's really cool, right? And the locals are very supportive. We have been working with them for the past 5 years, and we've been communicating with them ever since. We also get a lot of gifts from them from time to time. So we're very much a very fun company, I would say. So let me describe our customers. Our customers are consisting of travelers. But to break it down, we focus mostly on the support for female travelers, students, teachers. We also focus on newlyweds, business people, but also family, people who wants to enjoy. But we realize that from the demographic, we have at least 60% coming from students. So we are able to design our packages specifically for that, and we ensure that our travel budget fits for them. Yeah, so students can go anywhere, especially during summer. So our customer relationship is that we always have returning customers, and they recommend with their friend. We see a lot of referrals, and even our partners, our affiliates, they promote it, and they know that, okay, we have a lot of traction from here, and they want to get more out of it. They want people to sign up to our platform, so we're very grateful for it. Our channels are available on our website. We are also available on WhatsApp and Telegram. But if you want to check out some places before you travel, we also have an active YouTube community as well, so do check that out. We are also mostly promoting on Instagram, and we do promotion at least like 5 times in a month. Our revenue streams consist mostly of merch. We also focus on our travel packages. That's our main bread and butter. But most cases is that we also got royalties from our partners as well. So some of our partners see the benefit for both of us, and I think that's a really good establishment that we have at this moment. A lot of people like our brand. We have a really cool logo as well of a llama. Everybody loves llamas, right? So yeah, people travel with our merch, with the photo of our llamas everywhere, and we're very proud to hold that brand. So yeah. So to conclude my pitching, we're asking for $50,000, and that is going to help us to scale to even more countries. We're now focusing on 5, but we want to step it up. We want to take it all over ASEAN and start to look into Europe and perhaps maybe Africa. People like to go travel into these places as well. We see a lot of opportunities there. We're going to spend that mostly on our partners. We're going to establish some flights and do our own research prior to the trip, and making sure that our partners there are solid and believe in us, in our brand, and we can offer the same to our customers, and everyone's happy. So with that, I want to say thank you very much, and I hope you guys enjoy our brand, anywhere.co, traveling made easy. All right, so now, end. So that's how you basically pitch. You want to make sure that when people like that pitch, you got to pull in all the fun stuff, right? To be honest, I like to hear a lot of those pitching, because like when you see those, you know, shows on Shark Tank, they might be very, you know, very specific, and they would point out like, it's very tough, you know. And the thing is, we gotta really pull in what's so unique about your product. You gotta know your stuff. Thank you very much for the reactions. I didn't expect that. It was just a practice, guys. I've done a lot of practice like this, so thank you. Thank you for the hearts as well. All right. Okay, I see Romero, thank you for the comment, 25,000 for 7% of the company. Yeah, right. So some investors, they proposed back that. They said like, okay, you know what? You have a really good idea, but I'm not going to give you 50,000. I want to give you 100,000, but I want to have a stake in your company. So at least 7 to maybe 10%. 10 is really high, but it's not impossible. Okay, so investors would counter propose you. That would be a case. Okay, but for now, for BIMP-EAGA, don't worry too much for this competition. Really just utilize the business model canvas. All the information is there. And try to expand, even if you feel that, not too sure. All of these are one-liners, one words. So try to figure and see, okay, keep practicing. I've seen a lot of business proposals. They like to practice and practice and practice. It's really good. Yeah, until they get better. I'm only pitching just now. I was focusing on 3 minutes. I think I extended for at least 5 minutes. Some business pitching goes up to even 10 to 20 minutes, like I said. Okay. So, yeah, I hope that was very entertaining for you guys. Thank you again for the reaction. I didn't expect that. It was just, yeah, me running through it. But yeah, hearts to everybody for this. And I want to say, if you guys have any questions on the business model canvas, I really want to help you guys out. I've seen a lot of business model canvas and they always get very exciting. The moment you start pitching about it, wow, this idea is really cool. Why didn't I think about it in the first place? So I want you guys to be in that spot, right? So yeah, I want to conclude my workshop for this morning and I want to say thank you very much to everybody for being part of this. And I think the committee for BIMP-EAGA have been very supportive as well. And thanks for inviting me over. I want to say thank you very much to everyone as well. Hope you are all very safe. I think we're ending a bit early in this case. Before I end the session, do you guys have any questions for me or I'll try my best to answer? Okay, someone said, can we get your empty canvas activity page? Yeah, I think we can do that. Sure, can we? Yeah. Okay, so we're going to send a link on that one. Actually, you can send the one with the full one. Picture. You can send the one with the you can send the link. So at least they can refer as well. Yeah. We're going to share you the link and feel free to look into it. Yeah. Okay, so what's the favorite business I've pitched? Okay. To be honest, I don't have that many business. I had a project in Cambodia. I've also pitched before. So in Cambodia, I had a project. Basically, we're helping a community of women weavers. And it was basically in a small town called Takio. And the thing is, the community there, imagine the women and the men, they're all a whole ecosystem. And the interesting part about it is that some of the youths there, they did not get to study far because there's a lot of limitations, I think perhaps in the government and support. So that's a bit unfortunate, right? So some of the girls had to stop studying to help the family. And to do that, they start to look into, basically supporting to farming and things like that. Yeah, so that's one, for me, that was one of my most favorite pitch because we were asking for like, pitching to Maybank, if I'm mistaken. Yeah, we pitched to Maybank. We got a fund of over 10,000, but again, that was part of a program. And the thing is, we were told to pitch again to get more funds to support that. So very exciting stuff. Yep. Okay, let me share. Okay, we got, okay, the empty canvas, that's good. So I hope that answers your question, Nicholas. Shu, I think you've shared that already. Thank you, Lokman. Real, okay. Are we allowed to secure a copy of the module? We've shared it to the committee, but I think we'll check again. Should be good. What is the most important element when it comes to pitching? Good question. For me, practice. But when you practice, try to get your hands out from having the papers and really make sure you know your stuff. One thing as well is to always keep breathing and just be chill about it. Again, if you fail one pitch, it doesn't mean you'll fail the next one. It could be the next one or the next one. I really like it, very simple. Hope it answers your question, yeah, Nuralifa? Nurliha, what's your advice in coping with pressure, especially when doing the pitch? Okay, good question. So when I had one pitch before, one of my mentors said like, okay, I can see you shaking. He said like, dude, your hands, it's like this, you know? Then he was like, I asked him the same question. How do you get over that anxiety? He taught me, he said like, he just usually would just squeeze his hand. But in some cases, different people have different ways. For some people, they would be like, they do a bit of prayer. Some people do, they get their minds off. It's just like sitting on an exam. So you just have to look at some greenery or get yourself out from doing it, from the pressure. Do something non-related. That works as well. For me personally, if I'm going to do a bit of pitching, I will not look at the paper in the next 30 minutes. I just want to chill. I just want to breathe. I will talk randomly to someone. So one of it is that try to be you. I think that's the most easiest thing, as cliche as it sounds, right? So I hope that answers your question. Okay. Someone says about crypto. I missed that out. Or was that deleted? Yeah, I don't look at crypto yet, but no, I'm looking at crypto, but I've not invested on it yet, just so you know. But it's a very interesting stuff. My colleague Bobby has done a lot of it as well. He's commented, practice, meditation, run around, push-ups, whatever works with you. Yeah. If you know Bobby, he's been called Barefoot Bobby. Yeah, it's only because he runs a lot of marathons. He's an ultraman in Brunei, one of the top 10. Very exciting stuff. And yeah, he would really give a really good advice on things like this. Just yeah, do whatever works with you. Yeah. So, okay, I hope I answered all the questions. Any more last questions? If you guys are good, can you guys give me a thumbs up so I can know that you guys are enjoying it and doing great? All good? Okay. All right. That's good. Okay. yeah, top 10 barefoot runner. Okay. So anyways, thank you very much, everybody. And it's been a really exciting past 3 days. I hope you guys are all taking care of yourself. Drink a lot of water. It's been a really challenging year for us. But please do stay safe. Please take care of the people and person next to you and take care of your mental health as well. Don't stress yourself out. The COVID has been challenging us already, but please take care. Be kind to everybody, all right? My last comments, I think, in this case would be... don't stop learning. Even if you felt something or feel a lot of pressure, keep moving forward. As my God, this is not something from Finding Nemo, right? This is something I'm just going to share. But yeah, keep moving forward. I think that's how life should be, right? We're always looking forward and yeah, bring whatever it is from the past, we learn from it. So with that, I want to say thank you very much to everybody and I hope it's been fruitful. Do keep in touch with me if you guys have any more questions. And yeah, back to the team, the committee. Thank you very much, everyone.
Okay, thank you very much, Tuan Afei, for that brilliant and very informative session. Okay, we have now come to the end of our 3-day workshop. So I hope everybody, all the participants, have enjoyed the workshop so far. And we will see you guys sometime again soon. Thank you, everyone.
All right, take care, everyone. See you guys. Enjoy your lunch.